Are you amped up about this, man? I think I know I am, because I'm almost, you know, like losing train of thought because I'm so geeked up about it. You can make the argument that when these women assembled, that they actually rewrote the Odyssey.
Well, you all know me, don't you? You studied me last year when I wrote that play, Medea. It's Euripides here. Obviously, I'm not looking super well. I died quite a number of years ago, as you will probably understand. Just here to introduce my play, The Women of Troy. So I just wanted to go through the cast of characters. Obviously, we've got Poseidon bringing it up at the start. You know, he's the god of the sea. And he would like to introduce you through the prologue. So he kind of sets the scene for you. And then we get Athene, who's the goddess of wisdom, who in her wisdom allowed the Greeks to create this havoc. So we're not really sure how wise she is. Wise, though, is old Hecuba, who we see throughout the play at the front of the stage. Hecuba was the queen of Troy, no longer. She was married to Priam, who was the king, but sadly he passed away. Then we have the three, you know, different women that come in. We've got Cassandra, who is Hecuba's daughter. They say she's mad, but nobody's quite sure. She could be the most sane one in the play. Anyway, that's up for you to decide. Then there's Andromache. Oh, what a marvelous woman Andromache is. You know, she's, you know, Hecuba's daughter-in-law was married to Hector. You know, he was pretty hot. They say he was the Chris Hemsworth of his day. Then there is Helen, who, you just want to kind of spit when you say her name, don't you really? Also, you know, very pretty, but a bit of a pain in the butt, as it were. Alongside all of those, obviously, we've got Talthybius, who plays the part of the go-between, the messenger. He's a decent-ish bloke, but obviously, you know, back then, back in the day, women didn't get very many rights, as I wanted to highlight in my play here. And the end of a war was pretty bad for them all, you know. Everybody gets celebrated on Anzac Day, but that's really the blokes, you know. What happens to the women at war? That's what I wanted to kind of explore here. Then, you know, we've got another bloke, Menelaus. He's a bit of a... Euripides doesn't swear. You know, and then there's the chorus. I obviously didn't want to make them men, you know, so they're all basically women of Troy as well. We get Astyanax, who is the only Trojan boy who's left, but meets a bit of a fateful end, sadly, at the hands of the Greeks. Speaking of them, there are the Greek soldiers who rattle on and off and do nasty things to the women. So that's the play. So I hope you enjoy it. Remember that you're studying it to work out what's, you know, I wanted to say about the world at the time, really. So as you're watching it, think about what I'm telling you about these characters. Why did I create this? Why did I write it this way? What was I trying to say? You know, good luck. I have come here from the bottom of the sea, the salt waters of the Aegean, where the daughters of Nereus, 50 sea nymphs in chorus, circle in their intricate and beautiful dance. My name is Poseidon, and I am a god. I built this city. With Apollo, I built it. Every stone we laid, every tower, even the walls, we dressed and leveled with plumb line and mason square. So I've always had a particular love for this city of the Phrygians. And look at it now, a smoking ruin, devastated by the power of the Greek war machine. A Phoenician inventor by the name of Epios, who lived on Parnassus, with skills he learned from Athene, and probably with her help, designed and built a horse, whose capacious belly was pregnant with armed commandos, and managed to get it, together with its murderous payload, inside the walls, so that no one in the future will ever forget the stratagem that goes by the name of the wooden horse, nor the ferocious strike force it concealed. And now the temple gardens are deserted, and puddles of blood smear the sanctuaries of the gods. King Priam lies dead on the steps of the temple of Zeus, protector of the city. More gold than can be counted, and anything soldiers can loot finds its way down to the Greek ships. And all they're waiting for now is a following wind, so that after 10 years and 10 sowing seasons, they can joyfully set eyes on their wives and children. These Greeks who brought an army to sack Troy. As for me, I have been defeated by Athene and Hera, goddesses who supported the Greeks, and who, between them, have utterly devastated this city of the Phrygians. So now I too shall desert famous Troy, and all those altars and temples raised in my name. For when a town is destroyed and becomes a wilderness, all worship ceases, and there's no longer anything worth a god's consideration. Now the riverbank of the Scamander echoes with the screams and moans of captured women, as various Greek lords draw lots for them, and they become their slaves. Arcadian princes draw some, Thessalians others, and the princes of Athens, Theseus' descendants, get their share. All the women of Troy, who've not yet been allocated, are in this building here. They've been reserved for the leaders of the Greek army. And with them, a prisoner like the rest, and quite right too, is the Spartan daughter of Tyndarus, Helen. But to see the true face of misery, you need look no further than the poor creature lying here in front of the gate, Hecuba, whose unnumbered tears match the numberless dead she grieves for. Her daughter, Polyxena, has been secretly and brutally murdered at the tomb of Achilles in payment for his death. Priam is dead too, and her sons by him. And her daughter Cassandra, the frenzied visionary, whom even the god Apollo left untouched as a virgin, Agamemnon intends to make his concubine. A dangerous business, best kept in the dark, that flouts all religious feeling. Well then, most prosperous of cities, home of the rich and fortunate, time to say goodbye. Shining towers and citadels, farewell forever. If Pallas Athene, daughter of Zeus, had not determined to destroy you, your foundations would be as firm and solid as they ever were.
May our old antagonism be forgotten. I've something to say to you, brother of my father, great god as you are, whom other gods honour.
Certainly it may. We are blood relations, Queen Athene, and that warms my heart.
You are generous to say so. The question at issue is a matter of equal concern to both of us.
What is it? Some new dispensation from the gods? From Zeus himself or some other divinity?
No, it concerns Troy, on whose ground we stand now. I want to make a pact. Join your power to mine.
Is that so? You pity your ancient enemy now? You see her and smoke blackened ruin, do you?
That's not the point. Fergus, give me your answer. Will you join me and help to carry out my plan?
By all means. Though I'd be glad to know what it is. Are you helping the Greeks now, or the Trojans?
My former enemies, the Trojans, will be comforted. I shall make the Greeks return home a disaster.
A somewhat cavalier change of mind, surely. Are you usually so casual with whom you love or hate?
Oh, haven't you heard? I've been insulted, my temple desecrated.
Yes, I know, when Ajax dragged Cassandra from sanctuary.
The Greeks didn't punish him, not even a reprimand.
When your power had enabled to bring Troy to his knees.
I shall punish them for that. With your help.
I am entirely at your service. What can I do?
I want their voyage home to be a complete disaster.
Before they set sail or out at sea?
When they left Troy and are nearing home, Zeus has promised me a savage hailstorm, torrential rain, and gale force winds in the middle of the night. And he's given me the use of his thunderbolts to strike the Greek ships with lightning and burn them at sea. Your task will be to make the Aegean heave with mountainous waves, every third wave even higher than the rest, and swirl and eddy the salt waters with dangerous whirlpools and fill the whole bay of Euboea with floating corpses, so thick you could walk on them, so that the Greeks will learn their lesson and, in future, respect my temples and fear the power of the gods.
Athene, you need not waste more words. I shall do that with pleasure. The whole Aegean, from the shores of Mykonos and the rocks of Delos, to Skyros and Lemnos and the headlands of Caphyria and the open salt sea, I shall whip up to a foam, so that the number of the drowned will be beyond counting. You get off to Olympus now, get hold of the thunderbolts, and watch your opportunity when the Greek fleets cast off for home. When a man sacks a town and destroys everything, even sacred temples and the tombs of the dead, he is asking for trouble. The same destruction, sooner or later, will fall on his own head. Ah, welcome back. I hope you enjoyed the start of the play. I just wanted to maybe go through a couple of things with you that you could be looking for. I'm low-key pretty proud of the way that starts off. I mean, that adds a little bit of tension, doesn't it? That you know the Greeks are going to get their comeuppance. You know, I've got Poseidon in there with his big fork and Athene with her massive pride. So, yes, I mean, obviously, we learn a little bit about the gods in this respect. We learn that they are led in many ways by their emotions, much like, you know, humans are. Now, Poseidon obviously is a bit upset because Troy has been damaged and it was his pride and joy. He built the city. But he now sees it as no longer relevant because people are not praying to him. So that maybe shows you, you know, that he only really cares about it when he sees it as a source of people's adulation for him. Similarly, Athena, you know,
she changes her mind. She supported the Greeks, but now she's supporting the Trojans because, you know, the Greeks raped Cassandra in one of her temples and desecrated it. So she's upset because they're not being respectful to her. So both of these gods, you know, they set the scene, they tell us how terrible it is, but they also indicate that there is going to be further war and further strife for both sides. You know, the Trojan women are going to be divided up between the Greek soldiers, but the Greek soldiers are going to be killed at sea as soon as they, you know, try and return to their homelands, which is pretty devastating for them. And really, perhaps, shows us the pointlessness of war. And, you know, I was a bit of a pacifist myself. I was in the army, but I didn't really like it. And I saw the Greeks, like my country, doing some terrible, terrible things. You know, there was the massacre at Melos, for example, and you know, there was no point to that. During the Peloponnesian War, there was no point to that. You know, our leaders just want to be strong and powerful for the point of being strong and powerful, and it leads to countless, countless death. So perhaps you can see a little bit of that attitude in the way that I portrayed Poseidon and Athena, you know? I also hope you see that, you know, by putting Hecuba on stage all throughout this play and having Poseidon refer to her at the beginning, I want to make her the star. Her journey and her problems are perhaps a little bit central to this. Think about the women, as I said. Think about what happens to them. And think about the way that, you know, I use words and actions to draw a little bit of sympathy, perhaps, from you and help you to decide, you know, what's the point of war? And surely our leaders should be better.